The original Highlander was one of the first crossover SUVs to hit the market back in 2001. Now, 15 years later, I'm testing the 2016 Toyota Highlander Limited Platinum All-Wheel Drive. There's a nameful. Let's take a look and see if this latest third generation is still worth a look if you're shopping in this class. First-generation Highlander was a much smaller vehicle than today's behemoth third generation. If you guys remember the first one, it didn't even offer a third row. It was essentially a decontented version of the very successful Lexus RX 300, which first came out in 1999. Now, 15 years later, Toyota has definitely moved the Highlander even up market, and it's made it much larger to compete with other large three-row crossover SUVs in the marketplace. Now, this current generation Highlander was first introduced back in 2014, and if you look at it today in 2016, it's still actually one of the smaller mid-size crossovers in the segment, despite the fact that for this generation, Toyota increased the overall length by about 3 inches. It made the vehicle about 0.6 inches wider just to give this car a more accommodating interior, which was a major complaint of the first generation and the second generation Highlander. Now you can see the design of the current model certainly has the familiar Toyota design language. Toyota went with a much more sleeker, more premium aerodynamic look this year. The grille is certainly much more bold, it's in your face. Projector beam headlights are standard. Halogens are, unfortunately, are standard across the board. There is no LED or HID headlight option available on any trim of the Highlander. Now, this vehicle does come in several different trims, ranging from LE, LE Plus, XLE, Limited, and then Limited Platinum, like my tester. Now, if you guys go for the Limited trim, you'll get these LED daytime running lights as standard, along with other LED accents going around the vehicle, just to give it a more premium look. Now, these 19-inch chrome tech wheels, what Toyota calls, are standard on the Limited. They do fill out the wheel wells nicely, and typically I'm not a fan of chrome wheels, but I do think they look particularly nice, especially on the Highlander's sleeker, longer body. The wheelbase stays the same at about 109.8 inches. It is a relatively about 5 to 6, 7 inches shorter than most of its competition in terms of the overall length and the wheelbase. Now, on back, the look is basically complemented by these very sleek taillights. The overall design gives you the impression that this is a much larger vehicle than the original one, but if you look at the width of this vehicle, it's only about 75.8 inches wide. It's about 3 inches narrower versus a lot of its main competitors like the Honda Pilot, the Ford Explorer, and it's significantly smaller than the all-new Mazda CX-9 that the company just introduced earlier this year. Now, overall, I think the Highlander's design is certainly pleasant. It looks basically like every other mainstream crossover SUV. It blends into the crowd nicely, which is what you may be looking for in this segment. However, there is a refreshed 2017 Highlander going on sale late this year that has updated styling, front and rear, updated wheel designs, as well as a reshuffling of the content. That's a different review. This current generation Highlander has been around for 3 years now, and Toyota consistently sells about 150,000 units. So this is their second best-selling SUV right behind the RAV4. It's a pretty important vehicle for them. But let's take a look at the interior and see how it stacks up versus the slightly anonymous but very conservatively clean exterior. Now, because my Highlander is a top-of-the-line Platinum, the company's smart key access and push-button start does come standard. I'm surprised that remote start is not included. Most of the Highlander's competitors give that to you, even the new Pilot. But to lock the vehicle, all you have to do is keep the key fob near you. To lock it, just touch this little pad here that locks the door for you. To unlock it, just touch your hand right here. It's got a sensor, and then it automatically unlocks the door for you. Now, looking at the interior of the current generation Highlander, it's certainly very familiar if you guys know and love the corporate Toyota interior design theme here. Lots of nice soft leather, pretty nice looking materials, a very simple, attractive dash design. Now, the seats, I'm actually really in love with the seats. The leather is super plush, it's very Lexus-like, and it's basically reminiscent of my favorite living room lounge chair. It's a very comfortable, very nice seat to spend time in. Now, stepping inside the Highlander, it gives you that typical SUV step in height. So another reason why a lot of Americans love this type of vehicle. Now, shutting the door, the thunk is a little bit on the tinny side. It could be a little bit more solid. I've heard better sounding doors from its competitors. But again, push button start, standard on the Platinum. It's standard on XLE and up trim. So all you have to do is put your foot on the brake and then push the button here to start up the engine. And it's just that typical Toyota smooth, refined nature when you start it up. This reminds me a lot of the early Toyotas from the like 2000 era that I love so much. It's a very, very hushed and just quiet environment. Now you can see, looking at the interior of the Highlander, certainly makes a pretty good first impression. You can see there's like stitching on the dash, but don't be fooled, it's not like real leather that's on the dash. It's just that faux stitching that they use on all their other products. And when you touch it, it is soft touch, but it's kind of a little gimmicky for me. I would have just preferred Toyota to just use a regular soft touch material and take away the stitching. I do like the matte finish wood. I'm not entirely sure if this is real or not, but it does look nice. It contrasts very nice with the silver trim plastic. And most of the interior in here, it's typical Toyota quality. It fits together decently well. The door panels, this is the same soft touch materials on the dash without the gimmicky faux stitching, more of that wood grain. And it's very soft right here where your elbows are going to rest. I really like the round contrast here with this interior, with the beige, with the black, with the wood. One-touch automatic up-down windows are standard on all four on this particular model, so that's nice that Toyota gave you that. Now, the steering wheel, it's basically the same steering wheel that I showed you guys off of the Toyota Sienna. It's a three-spoke design. It's an electric power steering assist. It's pretty numb. It's pretty light. It's that typical Toyota feel. The gauge is pretty easy to look at. I like the blue rings around the tach and the speedometer. It's got a helper screen in the center that's controlled from this little controller here. You can basically change, you know, whatever you want to show. It even shows you a little all-wheel drive gauge there to show where the torque is going, so that's interesting. Looking at the center stack here, this is the latest version of Toyota's Entune infotainment system. It's the larger 8-inch touchscreen that you'll get on the the XLE models and up. The standard touchscreen is a 6.1-inch. It does have their Toyota apps system here, where you're going to give you your navigation, your audio, your phone, the driver easy speak. That's what I basically showed you guys in the Toyota Sienna. So it's nice that Toyota gives that to you. I think they actually first introduced it in the Highlander, if I'm not mistaken. The nav system here, you can see, it's the typical Toyota nav map quality. You know, the graphics, you know, they're not really going to wow you, but they get the job done. The voice recognition system is actually pretty good, so I'm pretty impressed with that. Your typical audio sources here, AM, FM, XM, Bluetooth streaming, USB, CD. It does not have, actually, if you go here to the app system here, I don't really find anything like Pandora or something like that. I'll have to double check that. But nevertheless, there is a refreshed Highlander coming out soon. I imagine that will have the even more later version of the Toyota Entune. There's no Android Auto. There's no Apple CarPlay in this. This is still a little bit behind in the times. Remember, this car came out in 2014. Now, a backup camera is standard. So all you have to do is put the vehicle in reverse and you get a nice backup camera. You have trajectory and distance markers, but no parking sensors in the front. I believe it has sensors in the rear. That's what you get on the Platinum model. So parking this thing, not terribly hard. It's a little bit smaller than its competition. You can feel that. Now, 3-zone automatic climate control is standard on the LE Plus models and up. I recommend you at least go for that trim. You know, I like the fact that the controls in here, one thing I really like about this compared to the new Pilot that I've showed you, there's lots of knobs and traditional buttons. There's a volume knob here to turn the radio up and down. There's a tuning knob right there. And then there's knobs here for your climate control to adjust what temperature you want. Now, one thing I'm going to gripe is the feeling of this knob. It's a little bit loose and wiggly, so I'm not terribly happy with that. It turns fine, but when I first, you know, wanted to adjust this, I was kind of disappointed to see that. I love this little storage compartment down here. It's actually padded, too, in this little area here. It's a really great place to put your cell phone, to put your wallet. Nice storage, very good idea from Toyota. The center stack here, it's pretty wide. You do have a standard 6-speed automatic transmission. That's standard on all Highlanders regarding up trim. You do have a little sport mode there with a manual shift mode. No paddles. This is a family vehicle, so don't try to go racing in it. Over here, you have your traditional Toyota buttons, stability control off or traction control. There's a snow mode, downhill assist control, and then a center diff lock. which is interesting. This vehicle has just all-wheel drive. It's not like the four-wheel drive systems you're going to get on the Foreigner. Down here that's buried, you'll have your USB and an aux and then a power outlet. And so it's kind of hidden down there. Looking at my tester here, the limited and up trims give you ventilated seats and cooled seats along with memory seats. So the cooled seat function, you know, I'm glad Toyota calls it ventilated seats because most of the times it doesn't really get as cold as I'd like. It kind of just blows cold air out, but it doesn't actually feel cold. But it's nice that at least Toyota is offering that feature. Now, the center console here is interesting. First of all, it is padded, but it's not wrapped in leather. It's just the same material that's on the dash with that fake stitching. The center console opens up in an interesting way. I actually really like it. It's a very large center console. It's very deep. There's another power outlet in there, so you can definitely use that for storage. I mean, typical SUV fashion, there's lots of storage space in here, which is what you expect from vehicles in this class. Now, the glove compartment is a pretty big size. It's not lined with felt, but it is damped. And then the seats, as I said, are very comfortable. Now, my tester being a limited platinum, it comes standard with that Pano sunroof. If you want the Pano sunroof, it's the only way you can get it. So you have to basically go all or nothing. It has a nice power retractable sunshade here if you guys don't want the sun constantly burning you. But it definitely lets in a lot of light into this cabin, even though my tester does have the cream almond-colored interior, which is not an interior color I would recommend. Especially if you have kids in here, it's going to show dirt like crazy. But overall, I actually prefer the interior of this compared to the Pilot, just because it has traditional knobs. But it definitely feels a lot less spacious in here compared to its much wider competitors. Now, checking out the second row of the 2016 Highlander, you can see it's got plenty of room. It's practically almost as roomy as the front seats. And that's pretty much the norm with this class. The captain's chairs are available on the XLE trims, standard on the limited trims it up, so that does reduce the seating capacity to 7. The lower trims will have a bench, which will increase the capacity to 8, which is something that the Pilot also offers, so that's a good selling feature if you guys have to have that. Now, stepping inside, pretty easy step-in height, just like the front. You have your 3-zone climate control here for the rear seat. You have heated rear seats as well, so that's nice to have. Now, shutting the door, the limited trim comes with this nice little manual retractable sunshade, so it adds to giving you a little more privacy. The door panel is surprisingly soft touch here, with more of the wood and then leather stitching, and then, as I said before, automatic windows for the rear as well. Now, overall, I do love this little feature here where you can flip this up or down to give you a nice walkway to get to the third row. It's very minivan-like, but it's a clever feature. I remember the previous generation Highlander had that little bench seat that you could plop and put down there. I'm not entirely sure if this one still offers it. I don't think so, but I'll have to double check that. Down here you have a standard household power outlet, and then I'm not entirely sure what that is. It looks like it's nothing. You do get dual map pockets right here, and then plenty of cup holders and storage. Now, surprisingly, my tester does not have a rear seat entertainment package. I'm guessing because the sunroof wouldn't allow it. You can option that in if you guys want on the limited and XLE trim levels. Now, accessing the third row in the Highlander is relatively simple, not as easy as the Pilot, but pull this little lever right here. The seat will flip forward and then slide up to give you a decent-sized entryway to get into the third row. Now, the third row of the Highlander, surprisingly, it seats 3 across, which I was shocked with because this car is much narrower versus its competitors. But moving the seat back here, you can see, wow, the seat actually, it came all the way back. But my knees are pretty much hitting the back of the seat. If you push this headrest up, that's nice. Okay. Now, typically the front passenger definitely needs to move the seat, or the second row passenger here needs to move the seat a little bit up to give you more leg room. But you can see here the floor's a little bit higher. It's relatively what you expect in a vehicle in this class. Now, the materials back here, they're not entirely glamorous. You have cup holders here, but everything is pretty much hard touch. There's a pretty narrow view here. Honestly, the panoramic sunroof does give you a lot more light in here, and it's definitely helpful if you guys get car sick. But honestly, the third row of the Highlander, some of the competitors definitely give you more space. I would recommend this mostly for kids or very short people. Now, our power tailgate does come standard on LE Plus models and up. It's one of the slowest moving tailgates in the industry. It's kind of annoyingly slow. And it doesn't have that little feature like Hyundai has or the Ford Explorer has, where you can kick your foot underneath here, or it senses when the key's opening and it'll automatically open for you. You have to actually touch the button. So much work, I know. But looking at the third row area here, because the Highlander is a little bit smaller, the cargo area, it is a little bit less spacious than competitors. With the third row up, you're looking at, I think, like 14
cubic feet of space. Fold down this third row and you're going to get like 38, just under 40 cubic feet of space. Now when you fold the second row down as well, you get about 83 cubic feet of space. That's not bad. It's actually about average. The new Pilot definitely offers more. The Explorer offers more. But overall, this vehicle is definitely still very competitive in terms of the space. Now you can see here, folding down the third row, once you put this headrest down, is relatively easy. You pull this little thing here, and it just folds right down. And you can see it gives you a pretty nice flat floor, and the load height is a little bit on the higher side as well. Now you do actually have a little storage area down here, which is nice if you guys need to put some stuff and hide it in there. But overall, the cargo area of the Highlander is pretty average. The hood of the 2016 Highlander, you're going to find the company's tried and true 3.5 liter 2GRFE. That's the company designation for the motor. It's a 3.5 liter V6, port injected, doesn't have direct injection. It's a pretty conventional motor by today's standards. Now it makes 270 horsepower and 248 pound-feet of torque. Class competitive numbers. The new Pilot makes 10 more. The new CX-9 makes less horsepower, but much more torque. The Ford Explorer makes more horsepower. The Hyundai Sonata makes, or Santa Fe makes more horsepower. But the Highlander, it moves it out pretty well. Now it's paired with either a 6-speed automatic, either the front or all-wheel drive. Now, a lot of you don't remember or realize this, but the Highlander actually offers another powertrain. A 2.7 liter 4-cylinder is the base motor on the LE, and it's only available on front-wheel drive. I'd recommend you skip that entirely. I've actually never even driven it, but it's a lot slower, and the gas mileage is not much better. Now, with this configuration with all-wheel drive, it's rated at 1824 on regular gas. This vehicle weighs roughly about 4,500 pounds. Now, there is a hybrid model, but that's a different review. That basically has the same 3.5 liter V6 with an electric, two electric motors paired to it to make 280 horsepower. But most of you are gonna buy this particular configuration. Let's get it out on the road and see how it all works, shall we? Now, surprisingly, I actually haven't had a chance to show you guys too many videos on the Highlander in general. It's a vehicle that I'm very familiar with. A lot of people in my family actually drive one, which is probably why I never felt the need to actually show you one. It pretty much, you know, drives just like a Toyota Camry. I mean, this car was always called the Camry of SUVs, and even though this current one has gotten a lot larger, it still very much holds true to that title. The steering on the car is super light. A little bit numb, devoid of feel. The gas pedal's light. The whole car itself just feels very car-like. In fact, one of the things I really like about the Highlander is the fact that it does feel like a car. The current generation Pilot, as much as I like that car, it feels like a minivan. It feels like a gigantic vehicle compared to this Highlander. So those of you who really like a very easy, very smooth, very quiet car, you're gonna really like the current generation Highlander the moment you step behind the wheel. Now, this is a family vehicle, so most of you are probably not going to drive it in the manner that I do. I mean, I only do this for demonstration purposes so you guys can hear the engine. But despite the fact that this 3.5 liter V6 is pretty ordinary by today's standards, it actually still impresses me very much to this day. Even though it doesn't have direct injection, it doesn't have cylinder deactivation, when you put your foot down, it makes a decent noise. It has a very aggressive growl that I wasn't expecting from a Toyota V6. Now, I'm pretty familiar with this motor. It's basically the same V6 in the Camry. Toyota's been using it for years, but it has a pretty nice sound to it, and it has very strong mid-range pull, which is not something you can say about the Honda V6, where it's a little bit light on torque. In typical Honda fashion, you have to rev the snot out of it, which most of you are probably not wanting to do in a vehicle like this. Really, what holds this car back is the 6-speed automatic. It is way too conservative in its programming. It does not want to drop a gear down. You really have to floor the accelerator to the floor to get it to get out of its top gear. Doing that to save gas mileage. Now, there is an 8-speed automatic coming in the 2017 Highlander with a direct injection V6, so I'll be eager to show you guys that when it becomes available.
Now, even with the traction control switched off, this car will definitely not spin its tires. I mean, it's all-wheel drive, for Christ's sakes. Expect a 0-60 time of just over 7 seconds, like around 7.3, which is average. The new Pilot is definitely quicker. This is about the same speed as the new CX-9, which I haven't showed you guys. Expect me to do a full review on that later. I will also be showing you guys the new GMC Acadia. I drove the old Explorer, and I definitely like the way this drives compared to the Explorer. It feels lighter, it feels more relaxed, it feels easier, and the ride is just so pillowy. I mean, honestly, you're not going to be driving this type of vehicle aggressively, and you really just want it to be a comfortable, smooth commuter car that's great on long road trips. And this is where the Highlander really excels. The visibility in here is just so easy. I mean, you have these gigantic side mirrors. You have a very nice view of the road. The hood is super low. There's no weird shapes in the back. It's got a traditional SUV look, so your view out back is not impugned in any way. Even though my tester does have the blind spot monitoring with a cross traffic alert, it's a nice feature to have, honestly. My tester also has the lane departures warning system, which is just a passive system. I find it to be very annoying. I actually had it turned off most of the times because it would just annoyingly beep every time you got close to the lane. It's just typical Toyota with its conservative programming. But overall, you know, the driving dynamics of this car, I actually prefer it to the new Pilot, to the Explorer, excluding the Sport model. It's just a very easy car to drive. The seats are just incredibly soft. The steering is so light. I mean, this car is not going to want you to go fast or anything. It's not designed to be that. But I appreciate the Highlander's honesty. It's an honest family crossover vehicle that's great for long road trips, that has a relatively spacious cabin, not as spacious as the class, some class competitors, but you get a much smaller, more nimble feeling vehicle that doesn't feel like a complete boat to park like some of the larger offerings that this segment has. Now, because my tester is a limited platinum model, it also has Toyota's adaptive cruise control system with automatic emergency braking. No lane keep assist, not available on the Highlander just yet. But the way it works like every other system. You use this little control stalk right here. You set it, and then you choose your follow distance right here. It'll actually shut off at around 18 miles an hour, so it won't come to a full stop. Toyota wants to save that feature for Lexus. But it's nice that Toyota offers it. It is available on the limited trim, standard on the Platinum, when you go for a driver assistance tech package. Now, coming up to the conclusion of my review for this 2016 Highlander, I have to say I'm rather surprised. I was anticipating to be rather underwhelmed by this car, which in some aspects it really does. I mean, this is a family vehicle. It's not exactly the most exciting car to drive, but it's a very pleasant car that I wouldn't mind driving every day. If I lived in an area where I needed the four-wheel drive, I needed to be able to seat 7 or 8 in a pinch, and I just wanted something that really just isolated me. It's very Lexus-like in here. Now, the interior quality definitely does not make me think I'm in a Lexus. The seats, however, feel as nice as any other Lexus that I've sat in. They're super comfortable, super supportive. I mean, honestly, there are times where I probably would fall asleep in this car, which is not good if you're the driver. I think Toyota should probably introduce something where it keeps an eye on you, like Mercedes has, where it flashes a coffee sign if you're starting to get a little drowsy. A drowsy indicator, that's what this car needs, because it is just so isolated and so quiet. Anyways, regarding the fuel economy, I've been averaging about 18 miles to the gallon combined in mixed driving. In the city, it was around like 16, which actually isn't bad considering this is not direct injection, doesn't have cylinder deactivation, and it has only a 6-speed auto. On the highway, I got it up to about 23 miles per gallon, which that was a little bit on the thirsty side. The new Pilot definitely gets better gas mileage because of that 9-speed. I expect Toyota to really improve it for 2017 when they introduce that 8-speed automatic, which is honestly what the doctor ordered with this car. The transmission is not terrible. It just at times you can really feel it lags, and it really wants to stay in its top gear. It needs those 2 extra gears for better fuel economy just to keep the engine in the meat of its power band. Anyways, you're probably wondering what the price is for this all-new Highlander. Now, there's no 2017 pricing yet, but this 2016 model actually starts at around $30,500, which is actually a little bit on the lower end for most competitors. Only the Honda Pilot is $200 cheaper. Now, keep in mind, that price is for a 4-cylinder Highlander, which is what you don't want. It only comes in front-wheel drive. It's so slow from what I hear. You got to spend like another $1,200 for the V6. It's a no-brainer. Get the V6. It gets just 1 mile per gallon less. on paper. In the real world, you'll probably be doing better because you're not constantly flooring it because the four-cylinder doesn't have any power. Now, if you guys want all-wheel drive, it's about $1,500 more if you guys want all-wheel drive. So an LE V6 with all-wheel drive is like around $34,500, which honestly is reasonable. That's about how much you're going to spend for a family crossover like this. Now, if you guys want a few options, I recommend the LE Plus. It gives you the power tailgate, the three-zone automatic climate control. That one is about $37,000, which is very much in line with a Pilot EX, for sure. Now, if you guys want to pack on the luxury features, that's where you need to go, you know, to the XLE and to the limited trims. The limited, as I mentioned, has the 19-inch wheels, the LED running lights, the heated and cooled seats, the memory seats, the JBL 12-speaker sound. The limited's going to run you about $40,000, I believe, to start. Now, this limited platinum that I'm showing you already has the driver assistance package, the panel sunroof. This one's about $45,500. So again, that is the most expensive gas Highlander you can buy currently. Now, the Highlander Hybrid can easily eclipse $50,000. You do get 8 miles per gallon better and you get 10 more horsepower. That's a completely different review. There's a reason why you probably don't see very many Highlander Hybrids because it's kind of just sticker shock, honestly. But again, if you guys are going to compare this to the Explorer, to the Pilot, to the CX-9, the Highlander is actually a little bit cheaper for its gas model. A fully loaded Pilot's like $47,000. Fully loaded Explorers can get into the mid $50,000 range. That's basically Acura MDX money at that point. So the Highlander represents a nice value quotient. Really only the Hyundai Santa Fe can match it. But there's definitely a reason why Toyota continuously sells 150,000 Highlanders. It's just a very, very easy car to live with. It's got the Toyota badge, so you're going to get reliability, you're going to get resale value. And those of you who are very loyal to Toyota and just need to upgrade from your Camry, this is definitely the vehicle to do it. And now, a couple of gripes I have, mine being a fully loaded model, is missing LED or HID headlights. That's just inexcusable for this top trim. It does have automatic high beams, but you still have a halogen bulb, which is funny to me because a Corolla comes standard with LED headlights, and the new Mazda CX-9 comes standard with LED headlights. So Toyota probably will fix that for the 2017 refresh. Well, they'll make it available on the higher trims at least, hopefully. But overall, you do have to deal with the fact that this interior is not quite as cavernous. It still tows 5,000 pounds, but overall, the Highlander represents a very, very excellent car for the majority of families out in America, or even those of you who are just looking for a nice three-row crossover SUV. So if you're in the market for a vehicle like this, I highly recommend the Highlander for its very car-like driving experience. I actually prefer its driving dynamics than the Explorer, than the new Pilot that I've driven, just because it just feels more nimble, it's smooth, it's soft, it's quiet, and it gets pretty good gas mileage in the real world around town. So those of you, again, who are looking for a vehicle like this, definitely put the Highlander at the top of your list, but maybe even wait for the 2017 model, the refresh, if you guys can actually wait long enough. Anyways, I hope you guys have enjoyed my overview of the 2016 Toyota Highlander Limited Platinum. If you're also looking to see the latest cars I'm testing, make sure you follow me on Instagram, like us on Facebook, and as always, guys, keep subscribed to the YouTube channel for all the latest Redline reviews. Thanks so much for watching. I'll catch you all in the next video.